260 years between those two pieces. Actually, it's pretty amazing that in some ways they have a lot of similarities, and maybe that's what we want to make it, the point of this program is to bring out some of the similarities in our very, very different idioms and repertoire. That fantasy that I play, the chromatic fantasy, is undoubtedly one of the most daring works that Bach composed. I think he was being reprimanded at that time for the strangeness of his music. And he was a young man and very daring, and he decided, okay, they think that's strange, I'm going to show them what strange is. And so he wrote this fantasy, and actually you may have heard it in many, many different versions. There are almost as many versions of this as there are pianists, or I should say keyboardists, because it was written for the harpsichord. And a tremendous amount of different possibilities of ornamenting it and bringing up tension and releases. What do you think, Bill?
Well, one of the things that I love about that is that he was playing all kinds of things as an instrumentalist, obviously, because he could write music like that that just transcended the instruments that he had to play on. Because the keyboard instruments that he was playing on weren't anything like that. They couldn't respond in that way. Mm-hmm. And yet he had music that's just perfect for today's piano. The thing that I love as a jazz musician about Bach and Beethoven and Chopin is that the things that they did are universal. And I find as a person who speaks a totally different language, that many of the things are similarities, are really similarities in that, well, if you say certain words in French, they're the same in English, or the same, no is the same in almost every language you can find. And there are other words that are very, you don't have to know the language to know what that word means. And so the vocabulary in many ways is just something that's very exciting for me to listen to and to borrow from.
I think it would be interesting to follow this with another kind of a revolutionary composer in the major canon literature of the 20th century. Scriabin really was a very important figure. Not so much in the piece I'm going to play tonight, which is interesting for other reasons, but later on he developed into his own style, and he was inspired by Wagner, and Romanticism became his tool, and developed a totally new harmonic language. The piece I'm going to play tonight, though, is interesting because it's just for the left hand, and it's a nocturne. He wrote it for himself because he had been competing with Rachmaninoff, who was always just a step ahead of him in the conservatory when he was a student. And Scriabin was what they call now vertically challenged. And he had problems with a small hand, and being a very diminutive person, he forced his right hand so much that he had to stop playing. And so he composed a couple of pieces for the left hand, which are very much inspired by Chopin. That's a nocturne in D flat.
Thank you.
I had another reason for wanting to play with the left hand alone. I had a mentor who was a wonderful ragtime pianist. His name was Yubi Blake. And Yubi had hands that were unbelievable. He could stretch 16 notes. Now I have difficulty, that's 10 notes, and I have difficulty doing that, but he could stretch 16 very easily. And so he would come to hear me play in some of the clubs I played in New York, and he heard me first playing solo, he did that. So he came back and he heard me playing with a group, with a bass and drum and so forth, and when I came off, I said, how'd you like that? He said, it was all right, except you don't usually left hand enough. And so I said, well, it gets in the way of the bass player. He said, well, you got to find something to do with your left hand. So the next time he came in, I said, how's this?
Thank you.
since the rest of our program is pretty much about dances, we thought it would be appropriate to start with the waltz form, since waltz is the most long-lived and favorite of modern ballroom dances, perhaps because of the ability it has to adapt itself to changing social conditions and to new styles of dancing. Chopin brought this form to a new level of elegance. Together, of course, before him with Schubert, and with him Liszt and Brahms and Tchaikovsky, and this century certainly Ravel again brought a totally different level. But there is something about the Chopin waltzes that is so special, and that's, there's not one that's not absolutely beautiful and fun to play. It's also great piano music written so beautifully. So I'm going to play the second one.
Thank you.
like to also mention that this this wall is probably one of the most popular ones of Chopin. He called it Valse Brillante, as to differ it from the others. There were few of these waltzes that were brilliant, and that's because it has a lot of showy passages. And actually, some of the most beautiful ones are his slow waltzes, and I'm not going to play one today, but there is a very special meaning to this Valse Brillante, and you can see why, and lots of runs and interesting pianistic things. Very difficult to film.
Well, one of the reasons that many jazz musicians, myself included, choose waltzes because you can do things. Once we were liberated from playing dances, we could do more with the waltz. And one of my favorite composers of waltzes is Richard Rodgers, who wrote any number of things for shows and beautiful waltzes. But one of his simplest waltzes is something he wrote with Lorenz Hall. I think it's one of his lovelies. He just takes a chromatic scale, and you know. And just does wonders with it. The reason that many jazz musicians like to play this is because the harmonies that he put to that chromatic scale were just as interesting.
Thank you.
chords. That didn't come too easily to me. So it's a little bit easier this time than it was the first time. I'm enjoying it a lot more.
Dance is very important where music is concerned, and vice versa. Many pieces of music have been written for the dance. Some are just in contemporary jazz are just written to be played, though. I like to start off with something that really suggests bossa nova. I wrote it for Dizzy Gillespie, but I wrote it for Dizzy to play on Sesame Street. And it is. I don't know that he ever played it in his group, but we have been playing it recently. I found it somewhere and picked it up. And it kind of suggests the kinds of things that he did when he played in the Latin vein. He was the person back in the 40s who really brought that part of the vocabulary into full view. He loved the Cuban kinds of rhythm. And then later he went to Brazil and he heard the bossa nova and some of the samba things that were going on. He was fascinated by that. He went to Africa and he heard some of those African rhythms. He combined those and things that he did. He was really one of the most rhythmically oriented musicians I've ever worked with or met. And so, you know, this is to get us started in this particular direction. I decided I would play this.
Brazilian, and I'd like to play a tango by Nazaré. Now, the Brazilian tangos are also derived from the habaneras, or the Cuban habaneras, and that's the grandmother of the tango. And they have the same kind of accompaniment as you're going to hear. It's just a little bit of an extension of the original form of the habanera, which is a little bit slower. This is a slightly faster tempo. Nazareth played in movie houses and matinees, and a lot of these were African rhythms, and they had African names such as Maxise and other names, but he gave them the name of tangos because it was a more accepted word for the upper classes for which he plays in his matinees. So the one I'm going to play is sagaz, which means cunning.
Many years ago, I had the privilege of working with one of the legendary Latin bands, one of the bands that really set the tone for what's going on in Latin music today. It was a great Machito band, and Mario Bowser, who was the musical director of the orchestra, was Dizzy's mentor. He was Dizzy Gillespie's mentor, and really the person who helped Dizzy really understand the claw and what was special about Afro-Cuban music. And I never forget the first night I played with the band. They have something called a montuno, which is a repeated figure that the pianist plays while the all of the drummers go crazy. They just do all kinds of things, you know. And at some point, when the drummers get tired, the pianist is supposed to play a solo, plays an octave and does all kinds of things. Well, I mean, I was busy playing this montuno and listening to the drummers, and Mario kept pointing to me, play, play, play. I said, play what? Play And so I had no idea of what the improvise against that. And so finally he came over and whispered, like, play jazz. And so I began to play the things that I knew against what they were doing. And it worked to my surprise. And so I was delighted, and it sort of got me hooked in the same way that Dizzy was. This is a song that I wrote called Picture This.
Contrasts, and it's really strictly for listening, there are some who think that the word tango actually came from touching, to touch and to feel. Tango is an interesting word because not two authorities agree on this. Some people think it's African origins, I think of it's a Spanish origin. But in any case, this is strictly for playing, not for dancing.
Thank you.
follow that with another very contagious rhythm, which is a rhythm of the malambo. Malambo is a gaucho dance from Argentina, and the gauchos are, as you know, our high voice. And we have here a dance that has always been sort of a joust between gauchos, who can outdo the other one, doing fancier steps. And it employs these cross rhythms, and it's often accompanied by the guitar, so you're going to hear the tuning of the guitar in the beginning.
Basically, the piece came to me. I learned a chord, and the chord was this. Well, having learned what to do with those six notes, I just said, I've got to put that somewhere. So I had to get a... That kind of seemed to work, so...
Thank you.
Many of the tangos reminded me of the ragtime pieces that got me interested in jazz in the first place. I had an uncle who used to play the piano. Play things like that. I thought that was neat because it sounded different from anybody else's. The fact that anybody else played Bach and Beethoven and Scarlatti and all kinds of nice things, but it sounded like I like that. And many years later, as a matter of fact, just a few years ago, I wrote a piece which I named after my uncle, who gave me my first Fats Waller and my first octave records. His name was Uncle Bob, and this is a tune.
Thank you.
Romania, though, really.